Thank you for joining me this afternoon for a lunchtime midweek devotional. Yesterday, I heard by rumor that there might be parking spaces available in the grocery store. So I went, and I came with a list. Well, that was sort of a waste to have a list because basically I had to just get what was available. One of the things I was looking for was ground beef. Well, I didn't get ground beef, but I came home with hot dogs. But as difficult as that situation must have been, and is for many people, it was a whole lot worse than the story I'd like to tell you this morning. It comes from 2 Kings chapter 6, verse 24, through 2 Kings chapter 7, verse 20. It is comes from a time when Samaria, also called Israel, is under siege by a bad king named Ben-Hadad from the country of Aram. The siege, however, is very successful, and so soon they are out of supplies. They are out of food. Things are so drastic that it takes many months' wages just to buy a donkey head to eat. And it says in the Bible that they also were overcharging for dove's dung. Now, please don't be worried. They weren't eating bird poop. Likely dove's dung was a nickname they gave to some sort of carob or some sort of seed that they would eat. But they still had to overpay. But actually do be worried because it got worse. In the story, apparently, they began to turn to cannibalism. In fact, two women in the story make a deal. We'll eat my son today and yours tomorrow, or vice versa. When word came to the king, he was horrified. And so the king decided the one thing he could do about this was call the prophet Elisha. And he called him and basically said, I'm going to cut off your head. This is obviously your God's fault. And Elisha said, God will fix this, and by this time tomorrow, food will be available and prices will be back to normal. An officer of the king, who's just leaning against the door, basically says, yeah, that'll be the day. That's not going to happen. And Elisha looks at him and said, it will happen, but you're not going to get to eat any of the food that's available tomorrow. Meanwhile, outside the city, there are four lepers. You see, social distancing goes way back as far as the Bible, and so people had to keep their distance from lepers, and lepers had to keep their distance from people. Well, obviously, nobody was coming out of the city to bring food to these four lepers outside the capital city of the Jews, and so they start to reason like, well, this isn't working out. Nobody's bringing us food. There's no food in the city. Look, what we should do is go over to the other side. Let's surrender to the king of Aram, and if he kills us, that's fine, because if we stay here, we starve anyway, and if he doesn't kill us, we'll live. So they go over to the enemy camp of Ben-Hadad, and they're stunned to find nobody there. And all of these tents are available, and the stocks are fully shelved with spaghetti sauce and taco shells and bread and milk. Oh, okay, all right, maybe they weren't. But anyway, they were fully stocked with all kinds of food. And there were clothes available in tents, and you can imagine them going through the food, trying on the clothes, when suddenly one of them says, what we're doing is not right. It is not good to have good news and not share it. Go back and tell the people in the besieged city that there is food available. Sure enough, they do that. And people come to the enemy camp, and there's such a run and stampede to the enemy camp for food that the king's officer, who doubted this would ever happen, was actually trampled by everybody trying to get to the food. And so, sure enough, he never got to taste the food that was available. I wanted to reflect with you a few things that I think about with this story. The first one is this. In this story, things seem out of control. And I think that's part of the definition of a crisis in our world, is it's beyond our control. We can't seem to fix it. And so when it's beyond our control, I think we do a number of things. One of the things that we know that people are doing is they're hoarding. If they do get to the grocery store in time, they grab what they can and even then some. And that's understandable. Doesn't make it great, but it is understandable. That's how people feel some sense of control in the crisis. Other people will turn to blame for a form of control. We need to pin this on somebody. It's the Chinese. It's the government. It's the people who don't stay inside their house and they wander over to the church office when they ought to stay inside their house. I mean, there's always someone to blame. In this case, they blame the prophet Elijah and his God. And I think thirdly, for me, a form of control is I just keep taking in more and more information. Facebook, news app, TV news, always looking as if more information will give me more control. And so in these times, we do feel out of control. Now, interestingly, what happens in this case of being out of control is when they realize things are beyond their control, the lepers ask for help. They get desperate and they decide, we're going to go look in a different direction for help. Now, they thought help would come from the enemy to the camp of Aram and the Arameans, but help did not come that direction. But I wonder if in everything else we've tried, have we tried turning in desperation, asking God to grant us help in these moments? Another lesson or thought that occurs to me is simply this, that the first people who experienced the miracle were the last ones you'd normally expect to have anything good happen to them. They were the victims of social distancing, the ones who were kept in isolation, these four lepers. And yet, in the midst of their isolation, it actually put them closer to the enemy camp, which put them closer to the solution to all of their problems. They experienced a miracle on the front lines of isolation. I hope and wonder if it might be possible that even in the midst of this crisis of social distancing and isolation that we are under, that maybe we will begin to experience some surprising miracles in our own life. Maybe we'll get to know our neighbors a little bit better. Maybe our political parties will stop fighting each other for a moment and look how they can cooperate to do something together for our nation. And maybe our own Methodist denomination will argue about things that are much more central, and that is how we help the hurting and bless those in need. Maybe we will come together as well. At the very least, my dog's going to be in a lot better shape because she's getting lots of walks. But good things can happen. Let's look for them. And one final lesson I would share with you is this. That when the lepers found the food and they stopped and said, what we're not doing is what we're doing is not right. One of the things they said is, you know, we can't keep this to ourselves for 24 hours. We need to go now back to the palace. May I simply remind you that it is always the right time to share. It is always the right time to give of the good things we have to those who don't have them, whether it's a word of encouragement or whether it's a roll of toilet paper. It's always the right time to share. My prayer and hope is in the midst of this crisis, we'll turn to the one who really can help. And out of what God gives us, may we share with others. Pray with me. Gracious and loving God, ruler of the universe, giver of every good gift of life. Give us, first of all, eyes to see you in the midst of this difficulty, and then eyes to see what you've given us. And eyes to see with whom we might share the bounty you've placed in our lives. This we ask in your Son's name.